So you've heard about how awesome virtual teams can be for growing your small business. Virtual teams give you flexibility, they give you a broad skill set, they free up your time to make more money so you can do more of the things that you actually like doing.
And they are a cost-effective way, as your business grows, to scale up without hustling your face off and thinking that you have to just do it all yourself. How do we know this? Because we've done it ourselves. We've grown our team from just us truly, to having over 14 team members working with us to make sure that our business and our membership, Atomic, runs like a well-oiled machine.
Now, it has taken us 4 years to build this virtual team, and we did do it one person at a time. But over those 4 years, we have learned a lot about the best ways to build a virtual team and the worst ways to build a virtual team. So keep watching to find out how to not make the same mistakes we did and how to get started right now in building your team too.
Let's do this!
Now, the first thing we wanted to talk about was how you create processes for all the different things in your business. No, don't snore, don't click away. This might seem a little dull. However, it's going to make your life so much easier. Whether it's your bookkeeping, or replying to emails, or updating your blog, or onboarding a new client, come up with a step-by-step process that you need to do to complete those tasks.
For example, in Atomic, we run what we call our accountability sprints, and these are a great way to get people to have that accountability to get stuff done. Now, as part of that, we've created a whole process around setting up a sprint. As you can see here, we've broken down all the absolute necessary tasks needed to set up a sprint, including the registration form, the emails that need to be sent, the follow-up, etc., etc. And this whole process is created in Asana, more on that later. The benefits of these processes is twofold. One, it makes actually outsourcing these processes to a virtual team member all the more easier and straightforward because they actually have a process to follow now. And two, even before you have your virtual team members, it just makes everything much more organized and streamlined for yourself.
Like, for example, before we outsourced the process of setting up the Atomic Sprint, we had this process written out and it took a fraction of the time us following the process and doing it ourselves because we didn't have to remember about all the moving parts and everything that just needed to be done. It was like, right, tick, 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 done. So the more you can process and systemize your business, not only do you have more headspace, but you also are setting yourself up for being able to outsource certain parts of the operation of running your business.
But even with the right processes in place, how do we know what to outsource first? Here's something that we've learned. Take on team members who add value and aren't just a cost. A big mistake that we see many small business owners make is they will go and outsource stuff that doesn't even need to be done anyway.
For example, if you outsource your Twitter account because you hate Twitter, but your Twitter account doesn't even bring you customers in the first place, and in fact, you get all your customers from Instagram, then that team member who's going to be doing your Twitter is literally just going to be a cost, not an investment.
A better use of your money would be to ditch Twitter altogether and hire the outsourcer to come on and help you make your Instagram even better and generate even more leads for you, because you've already proven that Instagram works in this example.
Or outsource something like your bookkeeping so you can spend more time doing the Instagram even better.
If you want your new team members to add value to your business and be an investment, not just a cost, then you need to make sure that they are doing either A, activities that are already proven to bring you growth, or B, activities that are absolutely necessary to your business running that will save you time so you can spend more time making more money.
Makes sense? If not, or if you've got any questions about this, then drop a comment on this video. We see and reply to them all. Now, saying all of that, we know sometimes it's difficult to know for sure whether somebody is going to add value to the business. And that uncertainty can stop you from pulling the trigger and trying them out. We've been there too. So here's what we started to do, which works a treat. Every time a new team member joins our team, they go through an onboarding process and a trial period.
Now, onboarding is a lot easier if you've got those processes in place, like we said before. But as a general rule of thumb, we think it often takes about one solid month to onboard our team members and teach them the ropes. And in that month, we don't necessarily expect it to go 100% smoothly, and we probably expect it to not save us that much time, but actually take us some time in teaching them how to do the thing that they're supposed to be doing. But obviously, once onboarded and that's all smooth and all the kinks have been ironed out, it will save you a ton of time going forward. And they've been onboarded properly, so you can trust them, you can let go of that control.
We also then have a trial period of 2 months for every new team member. This gives us enough time to make sure that they are a good fit for us and that we are a good fit for them. After the trial, we either then take them on indefinitely or tell them that it's not working out. And having that trial period is just a nice way of giving yourself an out if for whatever reason it's not working out.
Before we talk about one of the most important parts of building your virtual team, let's just recap. To make this really work for you, you need to create those processes. You need to bring on a team member in an area of the business that is going to add value. And you need to create the onboarding and trial period.
And what ties this all together is good communication channels.
I agree.
Now, we did not have this when we started. We had some team members that spoke to us via text, some via email, some via direct messages, some via carrier pigeon, and it was all a bit of a mess, especially as the team grew and the weather just killed so many pigeons.
Oh. So one of the best things we ever did was to create a central hub for our team in Slack, which is a communications platform, and Asana, which is our project management software. Both of these we started on the free plan, by the way, which you can access too. And whether you have a team of 2 or 3 or 23, this is going to be really, really useful.
Because having that centralized place, like in Slack, where your team can not only talk to you, but can talk to each other, is going to save you a ton of time.
And having all your projects and processes in a tool like Asana can help you manage who's doing what deadlines, who's done what, who's not done what yet, and it just makes everything run smoothly.
We do use a ton of other tools with our team, things like Dropbox and Google Drive and Zoom, and there's lots more that we can say about running a well-oiled team. So if you want more information about this, if you want us to create more content about running and managing a team, then please do let us know in the comments and we'll create more content just like this.
We really hope you have enjoyed this video, and if you're a small business owner, and please do make sure that you subscribe, because we make videos about how to grow your business every single week. He's been Andrew.
He's been not working hard enough. He's giving all of our tasks to our team. He's just not doing anything. He's sleeping until 10 a.m. Lazy sod.
11.